Your Honor, that would be me.
All right, Mr. Khaloon, you may proceed at this time.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court?
Yes, sir.
Counsel, Ms. Hampton, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, don't buy dope dealers' dopey defense. Just don't. Don't buy anything from dope dealers. Mr. Hampton did. If someone were to ask you, what was this case about? There is no question in my mind. You're going to say, well, we got a couple of young dope dealers trying to collect a debt from a customer, a drug addict. They go in there. One is stabbed. The customer is dead. They flee from the scene. One of them ends up in the hospital. And they both give statements. Okay, that's what generally this, how you would describe just in a sentence or two. And what I want to talk to you about is what happened in this case. And you be the judge. And you are the judge. This is what you already know. The charges, you already know. And it's all in your jury instructions. As you read them, you'll see who's been presented on what charge. This is the one thing, if you heard, neither one of them really want to talk about. They don't want to talk about their clients being drug dealers. Even though both of them admitted themselves. Listen to their statements. There's one absolutely no one has contested. It's uncontroverted. These two young men are violent drug dealers. Prime of their age. They usually don't love them. Last that long. Get killed and go to penitentiaries. But evidence. Defendants are drug dealers. Once you understand the defendants are drug dealers, this defines the entire case. Everything else will fall in place. That's why I want to talk about defendants being drug dealers. They're not selling candy. They're selling crack. They're not Jehovah's Witnesses that day. They're not Boy Scouts that way. They are drug dealers that day. And everything they do before they enter their home and after explains if you know and if you believe they're drug dealers. What's the evidence? Both parties kept talking. What's the evidence there? Okay, how about they say they are? No question about it. Dude owed them drug dollars, 140 or 200. What was that about? It was about drug. White man was what? A dope rental. Okay, what does that tell you? That they're drug dealers? Yes, they are. Why did they drive to victim's place? To collect a drug debt. Who was the victim? He was a drug user, a customer of theirs. They were armed with a firearm. Any question about that? Gunshot heard by woods and neighbors? There's a shell casing, projectile, and gunshot to the victim. And they both want to say, well, this is speculation. Just forget about that, ladies and gentlemen. Their job is to confuse you, to tell you that everything is speculation. It's your job to search the truth. And that's what I'm going to ask you. To search the truth and whatever that is. If that comes out to be not guilty, so be it. That's about rule of law. That's about fairness. That's about justice. That's about being reasonable. Their invitation is you to do nothing. Ladies and gentlemen, it is so confusing. The instructions are confusing. This case, I've been doing this 40 years. He says that every time. Forget about that. It's up to you. You decide what you have. It is a difficult, every case is a difficult case. It's a difficult job. And the society, you know, rule of law is always difficult to enforce. Easiest thing is to do nothing. And we are not a society that has come to this stage as one of the best in the world by doing nothing. We do things, tough things, we do them, and I'm going to ask you to do that. So that invitation about just go there, throw up your hands, be confused, and do nothing, disregard that. Nonsense. Possession of handgun by a minor. Let's start with the easy one, okay? No question, they're dealing in drugs. You read the instructions, they sold drugs in the past, they were there to collect the drug. No question about it, don't spend too much time on it. Next easiest charge is possession of handgun by a minor, because you're going to be required on at least two counts. One, that he was a juvenile and was in possession of a handgun, so you're going to have to conclude that. The second one would be that they were armed with a firearm if you find them guilty of trafficking. That's why it's important for you to ask the right questions. When you go back there, ask the right questions. Please don't start with questions like, let's see if the blood was tested, let's see if the... Nobody has raised that issue. In this case, things are pretty clear what happened and what was done. They were in possession of handguns. They're drug dealers. You think drug dealers need insurance? They do. Just like every other business, they need insurance too. Drug dealing is very, very violent activity. This is not, you know, going to a store and shoplifting. This is drug dealing. Drug dealers need guns to protect themselves and intimidate others. They were there to collect a debt. What is the most dangerous part of selling drugs? Getting paid. Getting paid is the most dangerous because people who owe them money, they usually don't have any. And they need their cash flow. And whatever it takes, they're going to do it to get that money. There was a customer here. He was a deadbeat. And let me tell you, I'm not going to try to tell you when he was Mother Teresa. I'm not going to try to tell you he was the nicest man. I'm not going to ask you to comment. You know, you go back, there's nothing in the jury instruction that's going to ask you, was he a... No, he was not. He was a drug dealer. This is exactly what happens to people who use drugs. He was a drug user. They're not people that people go around and neighbors say, hey, you don't come to our home at a, you know, Friday night party. No. I'm not going to spend too much time about it. They can talk all they do. During the war there, I talked to you about it. Can you give a fair trial to a person who is not perfect? I didn't pick this victim. They did. Okay? I can't have Mother Teresa on every trial. And many times we have to defend people who we don't agree with their lifestyle. The rule of law, rule of law, rule of law says we all protected. We all are entitled to the equal protection of the law, regardless of what our choices are, whether we have tattoos or we don't, whether we are drug users or we don't, whether we are prostitutes, whether we have AIDS. That is not an issue in this case. Forget about what they're trying to tell you. They want you to dislike this guy, so you would say, I'm not going to do anything. He doesn't deserve the truth. He doesn't deserve the fair trial. So forget about that. Customer was a deadbeat who was avoiding creditors. What is the evidence of avoiding creditors? You heard from the sister. Do you think it's a leap of faith to say that the drug user who can't cash his checks is avoiding creditors? Common sense, ladies and gentlemen, common sense. He was avoiding creditors, wouldn't pick up phone calls, wouldn't return his phone calls, was paranoid about drug dealers coming and trying to collect his debt. And what does collection of debt require in this case? You think they take a summons and you think they just go to the courthouse like say, oh, okay, we're going to garnish your wages, Mr. Drug User. That's not how drug dealers do their business. Each one of them tells you, oh, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with people going and trying to collect their drug debt. That is their sense of how this country is and how the rule of law defines this country. They don't find anything wrong with people going to others' home to collect it. What's wrong with that? That's a legal activity. Just like, you know, Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts going and selling cookies. To them, it's no difference. Selling candy and selling cocaine is the same thing. They don't see anything wrong with that. But please, you do, and that's why you're here. Both of them unlawfully enter victims' home. There is evidence of violent struggle. Did either one of them talk about that? Did they tell you, ladies and gentlemen, think about it? What we have here, we have broken legs, we got things all over the place. What did Daniel Hampton tell you? What did Mr. Hampton's sister tell you? He kept things clean. They don't want to talk about any evidence of violence there. Why? Because that would be consistent with usually what you would expect when a drug dealer goes to collect a debt from a drug user who is a deadbeat. What do you think is going to happen? Where's the money, man? I don't have it. Bullshit. You think I'd come in all the way? I've heard that you said, where's the money? I want my money. You think that all that evidence, they don't want to talk about that. Evidence of violent struggle, uncontroverted. Pictures for you to see. What comes out after victim yells, get out? Okay, why does victim say get out? He has just invited them in. You listen to their statement. He called and he said, Mr. Woods, Mr. McRae, sir, would you come over to my home in your car and let's sit down, have a chat? I already got tea and coffee and cake cooking. Just come on over. You think that's how it happened? Think about it. Common sense. That's not how it happened. Get out! What does he say, get out? Well, why does he say get out? He doesn't want them there in the first place. He doesn't want to be seen by them. He's got no money. Yeah, he can still use more crack cocaine, but he's not there. His family is visiting. One thing about this man is, as bad as he was, he doesn't want his family to know. He doesn't want them to be around when he's doing this. And you think he was going to invite them the day he had his niece over there at 10 o'clock? He was going to call them and say, come on over and let's have a party? Maybe on some of the days. This was not that day. Totality of the evidence, all the circumstances together, then think about it. All I ask you to do is be reasonable when you go back. Reasonable instances, not their speculation. And ladies and gentlemen, this is so confusing. For them, everything is confusing. Confusion is their friend. Confusion is an enemy for people who are trying to find the truth. Both defendants flee from the scene with gun nowhere to be found. Where is the gun? You know, they're going to claim that they're entitled to self-defense, but they won't say that we shot the guy. Oh, somebody else did. Where is the gun? Nowhere to be found. Well, he can't run anymore. He is stabbed. And I'll talk about that. It's unfortunate that he was. And, we'll talk about that in a second. There's nowhere gun to be found. Why? Why do you think he has to run? Why do you think gun is so important? They're young people. They probably had to borrow it from somebody. They want to make sure it's returned to that person. The only one who can run is Mr. Woods. He needs to run and get out of there. Shell casing, projectile, gunshot victim to the victim. And finally, the defendant's date of birth, as you know, is 8887. That makes him less than 18. It's important because the jury instructions require you to believe that he was a minor. He was a minor, and he was armed with a gun. Instructions. I'm not going to go over those. The judge has already instructed you. I have every confidence that you will understand them. Maybe not the first time, the second time. Third time, you will. And I know you haven't wasted a week and a half here, and now I'm saying I am in a hurry. I know you've taken good notes, you've been patient, and you will do that task, and you will understand them. I don't like to do it because it is judge's job. He's done it, and I am confident you'll understand them. But look at them, and this is exactly what's going to require. Everything that instruction is going to require is going to be there. Robbery and burglary. Collection of debt requires contact with the debt. How are you going to make that contact? Obviously, he's not returning phone calls. He's nowhere to be seen. They know where he lives. They have dealt with him in the past. So how do you do it? How do you get your debt? You can't garnish their wages. You can't use their credit card. ATM card, but he has the ATM card. Drug debt is an illegal debt. Creditors need money to sustain their cash flow. Debtor has no money, and he is dodging creditors. Daniel Hampton told you that. Tammy Hampton told you that. Neighbor Jennifer Tacker told you what happened the day before. Somebody was knocking on the door, and he would not open the door. Man has no money. He doesn't want to be seen by drug creditors. There's absolutely no question about it. Illegal debt cannot be collected with legal means. So the only means left at their disposal are illegal. And that's going to be unlawful entry and threat of force. Do you think direct, do you really expect, their problem is they want you to treat their clients the same way that we would treat lawful, legal people. They're drug dealers. They want you to put them at the same pedestal as everybody else. Give them the same presumption. If this case, if we had charged some Boy Scout, some Jehovah's Witnesses, I got serious problems. But I have drug dealers. There are inferences you can draw from their business activity. You know, when people have business, you see somebody running at the airport, you know they're missing a plane, that's why they're running. There are things that you can just draw inference. And the key to this case is understanding these two young men who have been on admission are drug dealers armed with guns trying to collect a debt. And everything else falls in place. Okay, evidence of entry and use of force. During their cross-examination, they kept saying, well, there was no force. I never told you there was force. I'm not worried about it. I'm not going to tell you anything that just is not there. Why? Well, it doesn't require. Burglary does not require use of force. And from what you've heard, that door, you could just open and go in. That's all. Unlawful entry. Unlawful entry. No breaking in the sense that, you know, they kick the door in. Neighbor saw them go in. Violent struggle followed by shooting suggests use of force. Once they got in, it wasn't, ladies and gentlemen, the way most neighbors go into each other's homes. By the way, knock on our door. and they sit down and talk. This is not that type of conversation we're talking about. This is not about, okay, we are here, how are you doing? You need any more, you know? This is not the type of they want you to think, to speculate that this has happened. They're in a hurry, in and out. Want to get out of there. What says Mr. Hampton came to the door to let them in? He actually says that. Listen to his statement. That's important, because he knows that that's how they're going to get in. That's their defense. Okay, now remember that. That would be inconsistent with what we know about Mr. Hampton's state of mind. And I'm going to talk about that, why that just is not true, that he came to the door and said, oh, hey, how are you guys? Let me open the door, hold the door for you. Come on in, here, here, and I'll lie down here. Do you think that's how it happened? Absolutely not. However it happened, that's not how it happened. And that's what's important. Victim's state of mind. We know he was awaiting and dodging. He had had an incident about a dog. Somebody's trying to snatch his dog. Probably another, and we never said, and I've never alleged. These were the two young men. I've never asked those people to identify. But we know, what we know about Mr. Hampton is that he's having trouble with creditors. Okay? They're coming, taking his dog as a ransom. We'll bring it when you give us the money. He loves his dog. His niece and her friends are visiting and are going to be back at any minute. He does not want to be seen with drug dealers. So the niece gets there at 10 o'clock, and what he's going to do is have them, have the drug dealers come over and pick up the money while the check that he's given to his niece cannot be cashed? You think that's consistent? Absolutely not. Nonsense. Absolute nonsense. Mr. McLeod, all I say about his closing argument is, ladies and gentlemen, look at the phone call. The same day at 11:45, the phone call comes from dude. Never bothers to tell you it's 7:28:05. Murder happened on August 2nd, 2005. Don't listen to what they say. He doesn't want to be seen. He doesn't want to be heard. Okay, now, so after he welcomes them, why would he go back and lay down on the sofa, sandwiched by these two drug dealers? Okay, you sit here and let me go. I'm just going to lie down. And by the way, we don't need to turn the music down because, you know, that's how we talk. Music is loud! And you think he's having a conversation with them? Do either one of them ever say it without music? No, because that, when people come in and you're expecting them to come in, they behave appropriately. Okay? He wasn't expecting them to come in. They didn't come in to talk with him. He did not just lie down on the sofa and chat it with them. That's not how it happened. Okay, why wouldn't he turn down his loud music? Why? Common sense. Somebody comes in, courtesy. Especially if you're talking about something important, you'll turn down the music. You know, uncontroverted evidence. Daniel Hampton said that if I was standing here and she was over there, we would have to make an effort, be loud, to be heard and understood. Under the totality of the circumstances, ladies and gentlemen, as far as they are concerned, he just does not appear to be in a welcoming mood. Whatever his problem was, 0.325, every possible drug in his system, one thing is clear, he was not a welcoming host that day. That man, the only people he saw and wanted to see was his niece, Danielle. And he was not going to sneak their 10-minute appointment while she was, you know, sent out so she could go away and he could meet with them. Nonsense. And the whole reason they unlawfully entered that place and robbed that guy, remember that, they, the defense attorney would keep telling, nothing was taken! Read the instructions yourself. They don't require you to ask Commonwealth to prove that something was taken. That's stupid. I'm working at a store, somebody pulls a gun and says, give me the money, and before I do, they run out. They're not convicted of, they're not guilty of robbery because they didn't take anything. It's a very attempt. What if they go through my purse and there's nothing in it? Oh, they're not guilty because they didn't take anything? Nonsense. Once again, mischaracterize the facts, mischaracterize the law. You alone are responsible for doing that. Please, trust yourself. Okay. Fleeing from the scene and hiding the murder weapon, this evidence of guilt. Anytime somebody flees from the scene, whether it's in a Kroger parking lot and somebody, while pulling in, hit another car and they run, that's evidence of guilt, okay? When people run from something bad happens, they don't want to be seen who did it. They don't want anybody to know who did it. Anytime anybody flees from a crime scene, you can just bet, ladies and gentlemen, unless they bring some help, we have to go to the hospital. They will leave a note, they'll call back. Fleeing from the scene and hiding the murder weapon, that is critical. Murder weapon is critical. That's the only way you can tie a gun to the bullets is through a weapon. If there's no weapon, there's absolutely no sense to test those projectile and shell casing. You gotta get rid of the gun. That's why Mr. Woods didn't stay there. It's broad daylight, the house is searched, everything is done, 2 days, no gun. Coincidence? There are other coincidences that are better explained. Now, murder. Remember, this is not intentional. This is wanton murder, okay? The instructions you have, Commonwealth is not alleging that they came there with the intent to kill Mr. Hampton, okay? That's why it's not intentional murder. It's called felony murder rule, which is a wanton murder. When people engage in a dangerous felony and somebody gets killed, that's what this case is about. I go into a store to rob, point my gun, clerk takes his gun out and shoots and kills a customer behind me. Is that person guilty? No, I am guilty. Why? I am the one who set things in motion. Felony murder, it's easy to understand. That's why we say, don't, that's exactly the rationale. People, you commit dangerous felonies, sometimes nobody gets hurt. You run away with the money you take. But sometimes people get hurt. Because when you're doing a dangerous felony, that means citizens might stand up. They might not play dead. They might pull their own gun. They might want to kill you. And as accidents happen, they might end up killing an innocent person. You, the drug dealer, 80% Detective Lawson, homicide detective for years, 80% of the murders in this city are drug-related. And it's not always the drug dealers killing each other. Many times, it's 5-year-old on the street.
Objection. Objection.
Judge, there's been no evidence other than the percentile. There's been no evidence about sometimes a 5-year-old gets killed or how many percent of innocent bystanders.
Okay. That's not what I'm saying. I'm arguing this case, just like they did. I'm not saying there is evidence, ladies and gentlemen, that I'm just saying, do you think sometimes the people who get killed are not drug dealers? Sure, I can argue that. They live in this county.
All right. That was all you were going to say,
yep,
was it? All
yep.
Right. I will roll the objection along to the street further.
Drug dealers hurt innocent people. And when I say Mr. Hampton was innocent, I'm not saying what he was engaged in was not a criminal activity. That's what they want you to do, is let their guys, don't look this way, let them go home and resume their business and life as usual, because Mr. Hampton was bad, because he was a drug user, because he had tattoos, because his family wouldn't support him. Understandable. I don't know how many of us would support a person like that. You do for a while. Man is trying to kill overdose. This case is not about that. If it was, I agree, he is guilty of what we charge. He's a drug user. He's a bad man. It's another type of people. That's not what this case is about. Who is responsible? There are drugs in his urine, toxicology. Where do you think they come from? Drug dealers. Who do you think turned these people into deadbeats? Who do you think turned them into basically comatose trying to kill themselves? Drug dealers. They want you to give them a break. They want you to give them a free bite at the apple. They want you to give them a self-defense. Saying, drug dealers, you have a self-defense anytime you kill a drug user. Drug dealers, you have a self-defense anytime you kill another drug dealer. We would have indicted this case had they killed other drug dealers. That's got nothing to do. The rule of law is not about people making decisions. It's a law making decision, what you can and what you can't do. Felony murder, because not everything thinks, as much as they have, drug dealers have control over what they do, that can't control the community, that can't control people. When I go in to rob a store, I can't tell everybody to sit down, and I can't guarantee they all will. I can't tell everybody to play dead, roll dead, play dead, and not say anything. The reason we have felony murder rule wantonness is because many times things get out of hand. Because what you start, you take a little rock, and the boulder comes down. And you say, I didn't mean boulder to come down. I didn't mean anybody to get killed. I was just drunk and driving. I just wanted to go home and see my children. It's not what you planned. Well, I didn't plan that there was going to be another car on the road. I didn't plan that somebody was going to, you know, one of the customers was going to try to shoot me because I was a drug dealer or I was a robber. You accept responsibility. Ladies and gentlemen, these are business people. They have insurance. I'm going to ask you to impose the cost of doing business in the community. They can do whatever business they want, but if somebody gets killed while they're engaged in activity, gotta pay for it. Penalty, accountability. Add a tax, a surcharge to their activity.
We didn't expect him to do this or scam us. We were just here to collect the money. Yeah, you go to collect, you're a drug dealer, you go into somebody's home to collect the money, and you expect him to just show the ATM card? He did that in the past. The man just didn't have anything anymore. Last thing he wanted to see was these people at the doorstep. Okay? Defendants were engaged in wanton conduct as they planned and carried out collection of debt. That is a wanton conduct, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not going to argue it more than that. The drug dealers engaged in wanton conduct. They were aware of the risk. They were prepared to deal with the risk by arming themselves with their firearm. They looked for the opportunity. Remember, Jill Morris, Mr. Cameron, said she was the most credible witness, what she said? As the niece left, the man came in. Coincidentally, as they left, the niece, 10, 15, 20, 40 minutes opening, they were, and she said she had seen that man that day before. She wasn't sure, but she said that. They had been going around to see the opportunity to go in. Why do you think they parked on the wrong side? In the hurry, because they know what they're doing is not right. They don't want to be caught, they don't want to be seen. They're lies, McElroy's lies. There was a third person already in the house who shot Mr. Hampton. Detailed description. Oh, Mexican white, 110. Listen to his statement. He goes on and on about a third person. Any evidence of a third person? None whatsoever. Mr. Woods says there was a third person. I got robbed and stabbed behind a liquor store. Is that Mr. McElroy says to Michelle Turner? When he's sitting there at her four steps and she's helping him. I got robbed behind a store. I got stabbed behind a liquor store. Never talks about receiving a phone call. Never says anything about the struggle. Did he ever say that he received a phone call from Mr. Hampton? No. He says that, okay? I got robbed. That's what he told Tech Osman. I got robbed. That's what he says. He got robbed. He got robbed. If you believe he got robbed that day, well, that's interesting. That's like victims going to people and saying, okay, I'm ready to be robbed. I'm in your home. Please rob me. Nonsense. Denies McElroy had a gun even after he heard the shooting. He never said he had a gun. No gun. That person, projectile, gunshot wound, shell casing, no gun. We don't know anything about the gun. And they deny that anybody saw them going into Mr. Hampton's house. What did Jill Morris tell you? They're both eye contact with both of them, certainly with Mr. Wood. Both deny that anybody saw them going in. Deny seeing McElroy remove his shirt. He says, I don't know if he took off his shirt. No, some of them are pretty good, some of them not that important, but it's up to you to put them together. Put all the pieces of, it's not just one piece of information, it's all of them together, what they tell you. Wood lies, dude called his McElroy. Okay, that's why I have it. Every call here, you see the last call is from 8:05 at 2:18 a.m. There is absolutely no call from Mr. Hampton to these people. Why do they need to say that? Same way they need to say, we got to the door, he came to the door, he opened the door, he invited them in. Because that goes with the story that he called them. Really, he had the money. You really think Mr. Hampton had the money that day and he called and said, hey guys, coming over, well, my niece is gone, I'll write you a check. Nonsense. He never called him that day. He had called him in the past. His phone number, same phone number, same name that they used. That's absolutely the last call that he got from them. They got from him. Dude opened the door for us, really. Dude goes to the couch. He lays down on the couch. I sat at dude's feet and my cousin sat at dude's head. These are his words. Standing was a total surprise. What a total surprise, really. Nothing happened. All we're doing is sitting there saying, hey, bro, how are you? He stops. The dog gets there. What do you think the dog gets there? What do you know about dogs? You think something going on, the dog gets there?
Yeah.
There's a struggle there. The dog gets there. Dog hears things, sees things, gets up there, jumps on the table. That's right.
None of them want to talk about the struggle.
Because that shows the use of force. That shows they were doing exactly what we tell you they were doing. Robbing this guy.
Stabbing was in the stomach, that's what he says. This guy,
never saw stabbing. Self-preservation, he chickened out. Talk about that in a minute. He didn't stay there. When things got hot, when there's a struggle, he ran out.
And he says that's why he's wrong about stabbing in the stomach and he's wrong about the knife.
This guy, he jumped out. He jumped the ship. He got out. Some people, you know, two robbers go in. Some have more heart than others.
He was younger,
but he had the gun. He knew he could deal with it.
This guy, he just said, you know, for me, things are getting too hard. I'm running. But tell you what, I'll wait for you outside.
Okay, I'll wait. He didn't continue running. Oh, my gosh, there's a struggle there. Let me just get out of this neighborhood. Get in the van. No.
He's there waiting. I'll talk about that in a minute. Never says anything about the struggle. It was a long knife and a silver top and a brown handle. He is absolutely wrong about that.
He was not there when stabbing happened, okay? He obviously learned it afterwards. Motive. Well, they have all the motive in the world to go there, trying to collect a debt, use force, unlawful entry. Think about it. All I ask is you be fair. Think about it. What is Mr. Hampton's motive? According to them, never had any problem with them. Okay? That's his statement. Mr. Hampton never had any problem with them. Mr. Hampton called them. Mr. Hampton invited them in. Mr. Hampton lay down on the sofa, sandwiched by these two people. Out of nowhere, he just stabbed them. What's his motive, ladies and gentlemen? Did they explain that to you? What is more probable? That's all I ask you to do. When somebody says, you know, it's a risk plane can go down, you still fly. When they tell you, probably will go down, you don't get on that plane. That's all I ask you is what is reasonably probable, not what's possible. Think about how people behave in their life, act every day. You think of all that, they never had a problem, he would let them use his ATM card, he would go with them to the ATM machine. That particular day, pull the knife and just stab them, boom, boom. Nonsense. Man was provoked. And here's a man who can easily be provoked. He's drunk, he's on drugs. Doesn't take a whole lot, okay? For him to just out of, he's been doing it for years. I mean, he's an old customer of theirs. Out of the blue, he stabs them. You want to buy that, right?
Inconsistent with obvious signs of violent struggle, homeowner's right to defend against. This is exactly where it comes in. If they were not the drug dealers and he wasn't in his home, ladies and gentlemen, we got a difficult case.
The man is in his home. Has no obligation to retreat. Can't go anywhere. Drug dealers are there. Collective debt.
Homeowner has a right to defend himself.
Okay, maybe some of us would have just said, go ahead and take the bicycle. That's where the keys are found. Go ahead and take my dog. Take whatever you need. You know, I collect knives or swords. Go ahead and take whatever you need. Maybe most of us. But because a homeowner decides to defend himself, like I said, in that robbery, most of the time, clerks give it up. That's what we tell them. That's what law enforcement says. Don't do it. That doesn't mean that each and every cashier and clerk and a homeowner couldn't shoot back when they see the gun. They could. And you told me in Mordia that you would respect that right. You wouldn't do it yourself. You maybe think the safest thing would have been to get out of the house and say, guys, take whatever you want. But the truth is, the man was entitled to defend himself. You can question his decision, whatever. And he paid. He made a wrong decision, if you think. Ladies and gentlemen, he paid with his life. He did. But because of that, don't let them get off.
because he paid it wrong. He made a wrong decision. He paid. It's time for them to pay.
Okay,
all we know is what he was facing is known drug dealers who have intruded into his home to collect the drug debt. And we talked about he would absolutely have no motive.
Okay.
This is important for Mr. Woods, because Mr. Kamenish, you know, he can't see any evidence of complicity. I'm glad you're here to see it, and I'm here to talk about it. They were acting together. That's all I ask you. Were they acting together? And if you don't say yes, well, let's look at the evidence. Physically together, that's important. If he was staying in his home, Mr. Kamenish would stand up and say, well, he wasn't even there. He was in his home with his mom. Physically together, that's one. Both are drug dealers. That's two. No, he's not selling candy. Each knows that the other is a drug dealer. That's three. Woods was present on two occasions when McElroy sold drugs to Mr. Hampton. That's Mr. Woods' statement. What's the evidence of that? Woods knew of debt and of the debtor. He knew they were going there to collect the debt, and he knew who the debtor was. Woods knew of McElroy's use of Mr. Hampton's ATM cards for drug payment. His statement, just listen to his statement if you don't trust this. Woods knew they were going to collect the debt. They used Woods' dope rental. Woods let McElroy drive. This is important. Sometimes what's important is what happened. Sometimes what's important is what did not happen. Woods waited outside for McElroy. If this guy isn't what Mr. Kamenish says, I've never heard him. Passive participant. Look that up. If he is a passive participant after everything has gone wrong, after he has seen the stabbing, after he has heard the shooting, a passive participant wait outside for his buddy to come out? A passive party says, oh my God, I am out of here. Mama, mama, I had no idea this was going to happen. Is that Mr. Woods? No, Mr. Woods strolls into the detective's office. Weeks later, Mr. Woods was in it in every sense of the word, passive participant.
Right.
Both got in the van and got out and ran together. He could have, first of all, he could have just run after he heard, saw the stabbing. That's why I say he never saw the stabbing. He knew that things were getting bad. He got out. Stabbing and shooting takes place. He hears the gunshot. He could have run. He did not. They got in the van and they ran together. They did not run in different directions. Everything they did together. The direction, the waiting, the going, the rental, everything. Absolutely. This is the strongest evidence of complicity that I've ever seen. The only reason Woods deserted McElroy because McElroy asked him to flee with the gun. He had a purpose to advance their complicity. Next thing to do was take the gun. Run. Because I can't run. I'm stabbed. Take the gun. There's no place to hide. It's 12 o'clock. We're going to find it.
Five, Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Your Honor. The two discussed the incident soon after it happened. Okay. What do you think they're talking about? They're in it together. This is a business, ladies and gentlemen. You talk about business. Things go wrong, you talk about it. Things go right, you talk about it. You go, this is, you know, just think of them as business people, and everything they do makes sense. The only problem is that they are in a business that costs lives every day. Dead man talking. Mr. Ham's dying declaration. You know, they're this crazy man. Well, forget about everything he says. Let me tell you, dying declaration. Think about it. When people are dying, last thing, you think that he's worried about, oh, this case is going to go to trial, I'm going to be the victim, I want to make sure they are framed, and they, you know. Only thing on his mind is to tell the truth, what's happening to him. What did he say? His condition as described by Officer Bazell, you heard, the pump is oozing out. Help me, I've been shot, I can't breathe. Did you know the people you shot? Yes, they got out of the van. What were their names? They were drug dealers. Did you owe them any money? Yes. And we'll listen to the 911 call in a minute. So, ladies and gentlemen, what they talk about in their opening, in their closing, you know, they talk a lot. I think I've dealt with what Mr. McLeod said about spent half his time talking about the phone call. It was a wrong day. Mr. Kamenish urge you to say that the last thing on the 911 call that Mr. Hampton said was, they shot me, okay? And I say, okay, that's what you heard. I heard him to say, they robbed me. Somehow he thinks that's significant. No. The only thing that is significant, they're drug dealers in a drug user's home trying to collect a drug with a gun. The man clearly said, they robbed me. He had clearly said, and you listen to that, whatever significance it is, okay? But he's talking about a robbery. They robbed him. There was blood on both knives. What was the evidence of that? This detective testified there was no blood in there. But Mr. Kamenish told you there was blood on both knives. No testimony, no evidence. Just look at that, that seems to dry down. One thing is clear, there was not a knife that was used. So what I'm going to ask you is what I do all the time. I take my job very seriously. I take pride in being representative of the Jefferson County people. For an immigrant, there's no more honor than that. I wear this flag with great pride. All I want to do is justice. And if you decide he's not guilty, there'll be justice. All I ask is to be fair. Rule of law. That's what this country is about. That's what people in this country die for and live for. I know some other countries. I know if somebody told me, hey, you new American, I'm going to take everything from this country but leave you one thing. No question. One thing, I want rule of law. We know societies where there's no rule of law, where people take law into their own hands, whether it's Afghanistan or Iraq. Here we take pride in rule of law. That's all I'm going to ask you to do, is guard that, protect that. And your verdict is about the truth and fairness. It's not going to bring Mr. Hampton back. It might send them to the jail. One day they'll be out. They'll resume their life and their business, and they will be with their families. Miss Hampton, she's not going to see her brother again. However bad he was, she'll never see him again, no matter what your verdict is. Remember, this is the last thing I'm going to say, and then I'll sit down. Your decision is based on the evidence that you heard. The one speculation that I'm worried about is that what you will speculate about Mr. Hampton. I am conceding, I'm telling you, I'm admitting. Okay, I know it's hard for his sister to hear. Yes, the way we look at it, okay, he was a bad man, but they are worse. When a worse man kills a bad man, law provides no exemption. We don't take law into our hands. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask you to find them guilty of each and every charge that's been presented to you. Thank you for your time and patience. Good luck.
Thank you, Mr. Khaloon. Ladies and gentlemen, 14 of you have heard the evidence in this case. Only